Welcome to this lesson on Romantic period. Romanticism is a name given to a dominant movement in literature as well as in arts, particularly in music and painting, in the period from 1770s to the mid-19th century. It is regarded as having transformed artistic styles and practices. It's a movement in art and literature in the 18th and 19th centuries in revolt against the neoclassicism of the previous centuries. The German poet Friedrich Schlegel was credited for first using the term romantic to describe literature. He defined it as literature depicting emotional matter in an imaginative form. Imagination, emotion, and freedom are certainly the focal points of Romanticism, and a list of particular characteristics of literature of Romanticism includes subjectivity and an emphasis on individualism, spontaneity, freedom from rules, solitary life rather than life in society, the beliefs that imagination is superior to reason, and devotion to beauty, love of worship, love as well as worship of nature, and fascination with the past, especially the myths and mysticism of the medieval period. It was a European phenomenon, particularly powerful in Britain, France, and Germany. The European Romantic movement reached America in the early 19th century. It encompassed many of the same ideals, genres, styles as the European Romanticism, and appealed to the Americans' revolutionary spirit. The Industrial Revolution was beginning to be fully felt by the people of England as the working class became dominant in culture. Most significant would be the introduction of the steam printing press and the railroads, which would make it possible to easily make and distribute texts. The Romantic period began roughly around this time, 1798, and lasted until 1837. The political and economic atmosphere at the time heavily influenced the spirit, with many writers finding the inspiration from the French Revolution, the abolition of slavery, and so on. After the agricultural revolution, people moved away from the countryside and farmland and into the cities, where the Industrial Revolution provided jobs and technological innovations, something that spread to the US in 19th century. Romanticism was a reaction against the spread of industrialism, as well as a criticism of the aristocratic social and political norms, and a call for more attention to nature. The English Romantic period ended with the coronation of Queen Victoria in 1837. The major English poets are William Wordsworth, Coleridge, Byron, Shelley, Keats, and so on. In America, we have Emerson, Nathaniel Hawthorne, Edgar Allan Poe, Henry David Thoreau, Herman Melville, Walt Whitman. They are all Romantic writers. Like many other literary movements, it developed in reaction to the dominant style of the preceding era. The 18th century is often described by literary historians as the Augustan era, the Augustan age, because it sought to emulate the culture of the reign of the Roman Emperor Augustus Caesar. Classical standards of order, harmony, proportion, and objectivity were preferred, and the period saw a revival of interest in classical architecture. For instance, in literature, Greek and Roman authors were taken as models, and many 18th century writers either translated or produced imitations of poetry in classical forms. On the contrary, Romanticism was associated with radical and revolutionary political ideologies, and regarded the classical standards of order, harmony, proportion, and objectivity. All the writers of this time did not think of themselves as romantics. Victorian writers later on classified them in this way because of their ability to capture the emotion and tenderness of man. Let's look into the main features of Romanticism. There is an emphasis on emotional and imaginative spontaneity. The importance of self-expression and individual feeling is there. Romantic poetry is one of the heart and the emotions, exploring the truth of imagination rather than the scientific truth. The I voice is central. Subjectivity is very, very important. And this is the poet's perceptions and feelings that ultimately matter. Then there is a religious response to nature that we find in the poems of these romantic writers, especially Wordsworth, Coleridge. They were concerned with nature, that they said that nature should not just be seen scientifically, but as a living force, either made by a creator or as in some way divine, to be neglected at humankind's peril. Some of them were no longer Christian in their beliefs. Shelley was an atheist, and for a while Wordsworth was he's a pantheist, the belief that God is in everything. Much of their poetry celebrated the beauty of nature or protested the ugliness of the growing industrialization of the century, the machines, factories, the slum conditions, pollutions, and so on. Then we find capacity for wonder and consequently a reverence for the freshness and innocence of the vision of childhood. For example, Wordsworth, Blake, and others' poems. We find an emphasis on the imagination as a positive and creative faculty. An interest in primitive forms of art, for instance, in the work of early poets, in ancient ballads, folk songs. Some of the romantics turn back to past times to find inspiration, either to the medieval period or to Greek and Roman mythology. Example, Keats. Actually speaking, this romanticism is not something new. It was actually a revival of something that was lost in norms and rules and tradition. The Elizabethan and the medieval romanticism, which was revived by the later romantic writers. There is an interest in and concern for the outcasts of society, the trans, beggars, obsessive characters, and the poor and the disregarded, especially evident in romantic poetry. For example, Wordsworth's poem, The Solitary Reaper, The Leech Gatherer, and so on. Byron's heroes. Then we find an idea that the poet is a visionary figure with an important role to play as a prophet, in both political as well as religious terms, that was also prevalent in their poetry. Let's see the poetry of the spirit. In poetry, the Romantic period began with the publishing of lyrical ballads in 1798 by William Wordsworth and Coleridge. This was one of the first collections of poems that strayed from the more formal poetic diction of the neoclassical period. Poets of the period instead used everyday words that the average person could understand. The words that we use, the language of the common man, that was the key focus. This also aided in expressing human emotion. Wordsworth primarily wrote about nature. He felt it could provide a source of mental cleanliness and spiritual understanding. Before Wordsworth and Coleridge, we have a few writers who wrote before them. They are called pre-romantics. They are Robert Burns, Blake, etc. Robert Burns is considered as the pioneer of this romantic movement, although he died before the publication of the lyrical ballads. His lyricism and Sincere de Marquem is an early romantic writer. He was a ploughman and a farm laborer, but received a good education and was interested in early Scot ballads and folk song. His most notable work is Auld Lang Syne, Tam O'Shanter. He inspired many of the romantic writers during this period. William Blake is yet another pre-romantic who is a visionary poet, who was also an artist and engraver with a particular interest in childhood and a strong hatred of mechanical reason and industrialization. Blake believed in spiritual and political freedom and often wrote about these themes in his works. Songs of Innocence and Songs of Experience are two of his most significant works. These collections of poetry are some of the first to romanticize children, and in these works Blake points out the innocence and imagination of childhood against the harsh corruption of adulthood, especially within the city of London. Then we have another set of poets called Lake Poets. They are the first generation of Romantics, who are called Lake Poets because they are attached to the Lake District in northwest of England. They are Wordsworth, Coleridge and Southey. William Wordsworth, who came from the Lake District, was the leading poet of this group, whose work was especially associated with the centrality of the self and the love of nature. One of Wordsworth's well-known works is The Solitary Reaper, which you are all familiar with. This poem praises the beauty of music and shows the outpouring of expression and emotion that Wordsworth felt was necessary in poetry, which was absent in the neoclassical poetry that came before. His greatest piece is The Prelude, a semi-autobiographical conversation poem that chronicles his entire life. Conversational poetry was the literary genre most commonly used by Wordsworth and Coleridge, with the latter writing a series of 8 poems following the genre structure of conversational verse and examining higher stand ideas of nature, man and morality. This poet is written in blank verse and is extremely personal and intimate in nature, with much of the content based on the author's life. And coming to Coleridge, he was Wordsworth's closest colleague and collaborator, a powerful intellectual whose work was often influenced by contemporary ideas about science and philosophy. Of his 3 major poems, only one is complete, The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. The poem tells of the story of a sailor's journey and his experiences on the ship. The sailor is cursed by supernatural powers and is only able to return home when he appreciates the animals and the nature around him. He is forced to wander the earth, sharing his story due to his earlier mistakes. His 2 other long poems are Kubla Khan, Christabel. According to Coleridge, his poem Kubla Khan came to him in an opium-induced dream after reading a book about a Chinese emperor, Kublai Khan. He was never able to finish the work. Christabel, on the other hand, tells the story of the title character meeting a stranger named Gerald who asks for Christabel's help. Ignoring the supernatural signs, Christabel rescues us and takes her home, but it appears that the stranger is not normal. His poems are supernatural. Coleridge was only able to finish 2 out of his 5 intended parts to this poem. And the last Lake Poet is Robert Southey, a prolific writer of poetry and prose who settled in the same district and became poet laureate in 1813. His poems were later mocked by Byron, but nevertheless, they belong to the first generation of romantics. And then we find the second generation of romantic poets. Succeeding Blake, Coleridge and Wordsworth was a new generation of poets, each following the pattern of romanticism of those before them. John Keats is still one of the most popular of these poets, with his work continually read and analyzed today, even today. Keats aimed to express extreme emotion in his poetry, using natural imagery to do this. He is well known for his odes, lyrical stanzas that are typically written in praise of or in dedication to something or someone that the writer admires. These odes followed the genre of lyrical poetry and focused on intense emotion using personal narrative. Among these odes, Ode to a Nightingale and Ode to a Grecian Urn are most famous. Keats was preoccupied with death and aging throughout his life, maybe because of his personal experiences, which is shown in each of these two odes. Ode to a Nightingale discusses the temporary status of life and beauty, but in Ode on a Grecian Urn, he explores the artistic permanence of images on the urn. Another writer who belongs to the second generation is Shelley, who was seen as a radical thinker for his religious atheism and largely ostracized by his contemporaries for his political and social views. One of his most famous works is Adonai. This was a pastoral elegy, a poem combining death and rural life written for John Keats. The poem mourns the death of Keats and his contribution to poetry. Another of his well-known works was Ode to the Westmen, where he discussed the force and power of the wild wind and shows the romantic writer's tendency to connect nature with art. Another writer who belongs to this generation is Lord Byron, who differed from the writing styles of Keats as well as Shelley. He was heavily influenced by the satire and wit from the previous period and infused this in his poetry. His satire, Don Juan, is told in 17 cantos, divisions of long poems, and is based on traditional legend of Don Juan. Byron changes the original telling of the story, and instead of creating a womanizing character, he makes Don Juan someone easily seduced by women. The cantos follow his character's journey as he travels throughout Europe, meeting several women and continually trying to escape from trouble. Byron's other notable work is Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, a very lengthy narrative poem. This poem was largely biographical and discusses many of Byron's personal travels. It describes the reflections of a young man who is seeking new beginnings in foreign countries after experiencing many years of war. This poem is significant because it introduced the Byronic hero, typically a handsome and intelligent man with a tendency to be moody, cynical, and rebellious against social norms. Coming to fiction, during this romantic period, the novel grew in popularity and became one of the major sources of entertainment for the middle-class citizens. Authors began to tailor their writing to appeal to this audience. Sir Walter Scott gained popularity during this time, both in Britain and also in Europe. He mainly wrote within the genre of historical romances and made this a viable form of fiction for later writers. Scott also focused on his home country of Scotland and often wrote about its beauty and romanticism. Scott's first major novel was Waverley, which is set during the Jacobite Rebellion of 1745. While this was his first success, there are other novels also, Old Mortality, The Heart of Midlothian, which are considered his masterpieces. And then there is another genre which became popular during this period, that is Gothic fiction. During the second half of the 18th century, this Gothic fiction began to increase in popularity in Britain. This came from a look back to medieval times. Often this genre would combine supernatural and mysterious elements with the castles, dungeons of the past. The Gothic novel combines the intense emotions of terror, anguish, fear, and even love. Coleridge and Byron both contributed works to this canon, this genre, but John William Polidori's The Vampire and Mary Shelley's Frankenstein's stand out as two of the important works of this genre. The first one was important for creating the vampire literary genre. Bram Stoker's Dracula, published during the Victorian period,
would continue to generate popularity around this vampires. On the other hand, Mary Shelley combines elements of love and supernatural in her gothic novel, Frankenstein's. This period also saw the arrival of other women writers. The Romantic period saw more successful women writers like Jane Austen. Writing toward the end of the period, Austen did not always adhere to the strict Romantic period guidelines and mocked some of the more extravagant plots of previous writers. Instead, Jane Austen chose to highlight the everyday lives of average people, making a turn towards social realism. Her novels include relatable heroines with adventures that the ordinary reader would likely to encounter. Some of her famous novels include Sense and Sensibility, Pride and Prejudice, Mansfield,